Ekphrastic poetry was in the ancient Greece, schoolboys were assigned composition exercises for paintings and pottery in ancient Greece, and this has been around for a while, and it's seeing a new life lately. I don't know why. If it's not just us, it's across the country and across the world. It's like it's coming back again. It's in vogue, and it works so well, I think, because we're becoming a more visual society with the internet and, you know, sending out Instagrams and things, and you get the words and the picture, and oh, that's a perfect match. So I have pulled some poems that are, one is ancient, and you will, I'm sure, all be quite familiar with this, so don't worry, I won't read the whole thing, from the Iliad, which is quite long. it is a description, a section where the shield is described, so I'll read that part. Then first he formed the immense and solid shield. Rich, various artifice emblazed the field, its utmost verge a threefold circle bound. A silver chain suspends the massy round. Five ample plates the broad expanse compose, and godlike labors on the surface rose. There shone the image of the mastermind, their earth, their heaven, their ocean he designed. The unwearied sun, the moon completely round, the starry lights that heaven's high convex crowned, the Pleiades, Hyades, and the northern team, the great Orion's more refulgent beam, to which around the axle of the sky, the bear revolving points his golden eye. Still shines exalted on the ethereal plain, nor bathes his blazing forehead in the main. That's very descriptive. I mean, you know exactly what the shield looks like, but it, the rhythm also lures you in, and that's a classic piece. It's, when you do your own Ekphrastic writing, of course, you don't have to describe every little piece of it. It can be an emotional reaction, and it can be maybe just one or two shapes in the painting. It's kind of wide open, but this one is your basic definition for somebody who's never heard of it before. I think it's a very good one. And then we'll expand beyond that and go into the 17th and 18th century. And this is such a tiny little picture. It's, I don't think you can really see it from where you are. It's a landscape. And, well, actually the way it's described, it really tells you what's in the picture, but there's a lot more. Okay, Bill and I were working on the pronunciation of this name. Théophile Gautier, sound good? And he described this painting in a poem. See now how evening from the mount descends. The shadow darker grows and wider too. The sky wears citrus tones and greenish hue. Scarcely enough daylight remains to see your name, Corvo. Corot, so modestly described, so it's a Corot painting. And the citrus sky, I mean, we were trying to figure out if we even had the right painting, and I went back and looked at it, and definitely this is the one that matches it. And he pretty much stuck to just describing what it looked like. And then as time goes on, you'll get more of the, through history, more of the emotional and political components in Ekphrastic art. And one of the examples of that would be from A Man with a Hoe, Francois Millet. And there's an American poet named Edwin Markham, and I know you've heard of him. It's, again, a tiny little picture, I apologize, but it's a very famous picture, and he's leaning over with his hoe and just standing in the field, and you can see that it's all being tilled, and he's got his fabric cap on his head. And this one is very symbolic of the efforts of the laborers and the political struggles. It's not quite as overt as some of the works in this room, but it's in the same vein. Bowed by the weight of centuries, he leans upon his hoe and gazes on the ground, the emptiness of ages in his face, and on his back the burden of the world? Who loosened and let down this brutal jaw? Whose was the hand that slanted back this brow? Whose breath blew out the light within this brain? That's a pretty powerful piece, just a few words. And I'm hoping that gives you some ideas if you want to walk around later on. We'll take a break and look at some of the pieces here and get ideas to write about these. So clearly, Ekphrastic poetry doesn't have to just describe the poem. It can be your reaction to it. It can be a symbolic gesture, sociopolitical. I mean, it kind of goes everywhere.